Hello, everybody. How are you? We're just doing a quick test. Nice to see that we've got some viewers in the audience, and I hope that you're all ready to learn some about PAP and see some cool videos. So, I'm here with Anne Smotla and Tim Lake, the two BAVAC transfer technicians. Tim is at BAVAC right now. As you can see, there's tape deck behind him, and Anne is at her home in West Oakland with a DV transfer station. And so Anne is going to be checking the chat. So if you have any questions for us anytime, just pop them in the chat, and I'll be keeping track, answer the questions in the chat. We can talk about them during the Q&A all together. And Tim is going to do a little presentation on some interesting kind of details about transferring tapes that have color issues. A really interesting topic. And I'm just going to go do an overview of the preservation access program. So I'm going to dive into that in just a second. All right. I just have to organize my desktop first. And let's see here. All right. So I guess this is our image, main image, but so this is kind of an informational session about our preservation access program. This is a program that we've offered for a few years now. We're really excited. So if you're here, you want to learn more about the preservation access program, if you have some tapes that you want digitized, you're in the right place. So I'm going to go over a presentation that just basically describes the nuts and bolts of the program. Describes how to apply, what makes a good application, who's eligible, right? Like the nuts and bolts. And then when I'm done with my presentation, I'm gonna hand it off to Tim, and Tim's gonna give a little presentation about some work that he's done with U-matic tapes. And then when we're done with that, I'm gonna show about a 30-minute clip reel of works that we digitized over the last year. And then we can also actually, before I show the clips, we can have a Q&A, we can talk, and then we'll show the clips. Then we can talk more about the clips and Q&A. If you have any questions about what you saw or the quality of what you saw, we'd be happy to chat about it all together. So stay tuned, and I'm going to dive into the presentation now. So who's BAVAC? BAVAC, we are a 45-year-old media-based nonprofit in San Francisco. We're currently located in the Mission, right next to Potrero Hill. At Bryant and Mariposa, and we have been through a lot of iterations. BAVAC has changed a lot, but we've always been really into media advocacy, giving a voice to those who have stories whose stories aren't often told. We have a bunch of programs. We have a number of fellowship programs, youth fellowship programs for education, where we teach youth how to do cohorts of youth how to make videos, how to tell their stories. We have classes that are available to youth and to adults. We have a Media Maker Fellowship, which is a very well-known fellowship in the documentary field, where filmmakers who are working in a documentary can get funding to go to festivals and basically be in a cohort of other documentary filmmakers to bring their documentary kind of to the finishing stages. And then there's the preservation department. So the preservation department, there's five of us right now. From left to right, there's Tim and me, Dave and Zach. And we're the people who are going to be, handling and digitizing the tapes. We have a lot of experience between the five of us, a lot of experience working with analog tape media, some experience with film, also experience with audio. So we're, when you bring the tapes in to get them digitized, we're the ones that are going to be handling it. So BAVAC in general has a number of contributions to the audiovisual archiving field. We digitize a bunch of materials, but we also do a lot of work writing up guides and doing documentation to try to kind of advance the state of the art of digitization. We're really interested in making sure that anything that we learn along the way about digitization gets put out into the public and is easily accessible. Even from the very earliest days of BAVAC preservation, we've been about documentation. And you can actually find documentation in that the first kind of BAVAC preservation staff had put together that still people are still reading today, and it still is applicable today. We also advocate for the support, like advocate for the importance of paid media digitization. We publish new technologies, and we also, for a while, we have supported the development of free and accessible open source tools. I'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. So we have a number of tools and kind of resource guides available online. The big three are AV Artifact Atlas, QC Tools, and AV Compass. AV Artifact Atlas is a website. It's actually, it used to be at a much different URL, but thanks to Harvard's support, we have the URL avartifactatlas.com. And if you go there, it's essentially a wiki that has information about various common tape errors. And these tape errors, it kind of describes how they happen, how they can be fixed, if they can be fixed, how to mitigate them, what causes them. Basically, we made this because we wanted to make sure that people knew, you know, like some errors can't be fixed, some errors can be fixed. And it's just put a link in the chat. Thank you, Anne. And this is just a really great resource, especially if you were to get a bunch of work digitized from us. We provide notes about the transfers that have information about the signal quality, and we use vocabulary from the AV Artifact Atlas. So if you're confused about an error or something, or confused about our terminology, you can go here and kind of learn more about it. Next, we've got QC Tools. QC Tools is a standalone application that's used to analyze video signals. So what you see here is a bunch of kind of graphs. Essentially, all these different attributes about the video signal are broken into graphs and charts, and then you can use those to find errors. What's really good is that QC Tools can see things that the naked eye can't see. So we found that certain equipment, while it said it would do one thing, it actually did another. Basically, we can find a lot of errors in the system and errors with our transfers using this. So whenever we're doing quality control ourselves, we use QC Tools on the files to make sure that the files are 100% correct before we give them back. But this tool is also free and open source, free for anyone to use, and we highly recommend that, you know, if you're an organization and you're receiving videos from a digitization vendor, that you use QC Tools to ensure that they're digitized properly. And then we've got AV Compass. So AV Compass is kind of a two-parter. There's a series of videos that just talk about how to do preservation, how to properly inventory and preserve and handle and take care and describe your collection. So if you've got a box of tapes somewhere or a box of audiovisual or audio materials, you can go to AV Compass and watch these videos, and they'll sort of give you some guides as to how to get started preserving those. So this is something that we recommend to applicants. If you're writing out an application, walking through AV Compass can actually kind of help you get prepared for filling out that application. Part of the application, I'll talk a little bit more about this later, part of the application requests that you fill out an inventory or submit an inventory, and this can help you do that. The second part of AV Compass is actually sort of a worksheet that you fill out that creates an inventory for you. And then you'll always have an inventory. It's always accessible online, and then you can export it to a file that you can then turn into the application software. So now we're going to dive into what the preservation program is. So through funding from the National Endowment for the Arts and the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, we're able to offer a 50% discount on preservation services to applicants. So you apply, and if your application is accepted, you can receive up to 50% discount on our preservation services. So sorry, a little bit of cough. So looking into what kind of applications are eligible, there's really a kind of a wide range. In general, we say that the material needs to be culturally significant or artistically, or have some sort of artistic merit. Now that, of course, is sort of a wide range, but this is the kind of footage that has been accepted in the past. Video art, documentation of artists at work, performances, readings, rehearsals, interviews, lectures, documentaries, documentary elements, community media, that's a big one. We're really into preserving kind of the passive public broadcasting community media. Artistic works on film transferred to video. So we only work with video tapes and audio tapes. But if there was a film that was transferred to video, and it has artistic value, that would be applicable. And then radio programs as well. This isn't an all-inclusive list, but so if you have questions about the eligibility of your collection, feel free to ask. So who can apply? We encourage individuals. It says here individual artists, but individuals with collections that fit the criteria are welcome to apply. And then the cultural heritage organizations, arts organizations, libraries, archives, historical societies. We've done work for a few historical societies, which is great. I mean, this is culturally significant work that is very sort of micro-regional, and we really like that because we're really about telling stories, even, you know, these kind of micro-regional stories. Archives with arts-related content or culturally significant content. Filmmakers working with archival materials. That's a big one. We really invite filmmakers, you know, or are a filmmaker and you have elements from your film that need to be digitized because the film is old enough to have had elements on tape, you're welcome to apply. The one big caveat is that you must be based in the U.S. We are looking at expanding and making this program kind of eligible for across the world, but we don't have that funding solidified yet. So here's a list of former participants. So you may recognize some names on this, and you may not recognize sort of... this is a nice hodgepodge. A lot of this work, this is work that we're really proud to have been involved with. We're really proud to be have worked with all of these people. All the work that we do through this program is really excellent. And then program demographics. These numbers are a little funny, but what these numbers actually represent is what percentage of the collections contained material that was kind of representations of or discussions of individuals or communities from these demographics. So 44% of the collections that we've processed over the past few years have contained trans or non-binary individuals or communities, gay, 60% gay, lesbian. I'm not going to walk through these numbers, but as you can see, we do have a fairly good we're getting a lot of materials that are representing these kind of historically underdocumented, underrepresented, underprivileged individuals and communities. And you can see we have pretty low on the Hawaiian Native and Pacific Islander communities. So if you have any work pertaining to those communities, we'd love to get it. We really want to make sure that we're giving a voice to everybody that we can. So quick little intro, you know, what is preservation? So preservation is the art of making things last. Preservation is really just making sure that that things can be seen and accessed into the future. Now, with video in particular, preservation comes, there's, so we've got inventorying is sort of making sure that you have a list of all your materials. We really try to tell people that you shouldn't start digitizing something before you have your inventory. And because, you know, you may have doubles, you may have duplicates, and also resources are finite. Most people don't have unlimited funds to digitize everything. So you really want to know everything that you have so that you know where to prioritize your resources. Condition assessment just means that you've kind of looked over your tapes and figured out what condition things are in. Again, this is a really great way to prioritize. If you find that a number of your important tapes are damaged or deteriorating or moldy or something serious like that, then you can prioritize that and use what limited resources you have to prioritize that work. Reformatting and digitization, that is what we do. So the condition assessment and the reformatting and digitization is what we do at BAVC. When we receive your tapes, we assess the condition of all your materials, and then we reformat and digitize. So the whole reformatting concept for video and audio materials on tape are really important because tape was never meant to last this long. The formulations of the tape, the chemical formulations, were just not designed to last this long. Most of the tapes that we digitize nowadays are past their advertised shelf life. We're still able to capture them using remediation techniques and specialty equipment, but it's just the sad fact of the matter is that these tapes are past their shelf life and they are deteriorating at a rapid rate. Now, film is different. Some people think that, you know, say that you can digitize film for preservation, and others believe that film should just be transferred to another piece of optical film. That's an argument for another day. But with video and audio on tape specifically, that is needs to be reformatted. And then there's long-term storage, accessibility concerns, and disaster planning. These aren't things that BAVC, that we do at BAVC. We don't have a long-term storage facility. We don't have an accessible, like an access platform, and we don't help write disaster plans, but we can point you in the right direction. And again, preservation isn't an action that you do and is over. Preservation is a series of actions that you perform and a series of policies that you create to make sure that your work can be accessed into the future. You can't just have preservation, you can maintain preservation. So there's kind of this dichotomy between preservation and access. We have both of them in the name of the program. It's the Preservation Access Program. So both preservation and access are very important. Preservation, as I said before, is the art of making things last. So you kind of have a picture of a safe and a hard drive. But for access, access is equally important for this program in general. So we are going to prioritize applications from people who have a plan for access, who have a plan to provide access to the materials that are being digitized. That's just, you know, that is what we're prioritizing. The funding that we get from funders, is prioritizing that. So we're going to give priority to somebody who says, hey, I'm going to make these digitizing materials available to researchers or to viewers, over somebody who says, yeah, you know, the people are going to have to pay to get access to this, or I can't really provide access to this. Though we are sensitive to concerns that understanding that if this is material that is of some sensitive community, indigenous ceremonies that aren't meant to be viewed by the public, that doesn't disqualify you for eligibility for this program, but you'll have to describe in your application, like, who's gaining access. You know, access doesn't mean on the internet and available to everybody, but it does mean that you have to have a plan for creating access and providing access to your intended audience. 1 minute, please. So this is what's gonna happen when you bring in your tapes. So the process that we go through when we're doing tape to file transfers is we bake and clean the tapes. Some people don't, we will not bake tapes. If you don't want your tapes to be baked, we won't do it. However, we've had really good luck with baking. I'm happy to answer questions about that afterwards. We stabilize the video using a time-based corrector. We calibrate the signals according to the color bars. If there's no color bars, we do our best using our eyes. We're all well-trained in setting levels. We digitize the entire tape to uncompressed digital video formats. We document any issues and provide you a detailed transfer log of all of those issues, as well as we also document all the equipment we use, the signal chain we use, any thing that we had done during the transfer. And we document details about the tape, how many channels of audio there were, what kind of signal chain we used, what the original color, if it was color or black and white. Then we create derivatives for you, so I'll describe that later. And then we communicate any issues and solutions. So if we get a bunch of tapes in that are not playing, that are damaging our decks, that are having problems, we're going to call you up or send you an email and discuss what the next steps are. We don't take any extreme measures without discussing it with you. And then here's just a list of supported formats. We do really a lot of formats. There are some things that we can't do. We don't really have PAL. So what we mostly do is NTSC. If your video was shot in North America or South America or some other, or Japan or a number of other countries, we can do it. If your footage was shot in the UK, France, the Middle East, or Russia, or Asia in general, that besides Japan, we probably can't do it, though happy to discuss. This is another reason why we kind of focus on US-based stuff, even though we know that there are US-based collections that were shot elsewhere. But half-inch open reel, that's the first home video format that was really available. We don't do 2-inch, the broadcast 2-inch quadruplex video. Those decks are about the size of a washer-dryer combo, or bigger, about twice the size of a washer-dryer combo. And we can suggest people to take your 2-inch tapes too if you do have 2-inch tapes. But we can do 1-inch. We can do 3/4-inch U-matic, Betamax, the whole Beta family, the whole VHS family, the whole high 8mm family, the whole DV family. We can't do HDV, but if you have an HDV collection, talk to me about it. And we can do 1/4-inch audio reel-to-reels and audio cassettes. So when you come in and bring your materials, what you're going to get from us is a supervised transfer by a skilled technician. You're going to get files that meet specifications set by thought leaders in the field. You're going to get derivatives. So the access and the mezzanine derivatives, the files, the kind of preservation files that you get are going to be really big. They're 100 gigabytes an hour. So those files are just meant to be locked up in a lock with a key in your archive, not to be touched. They're for preservation. But the mezzanine and the access files, the mezzanine file is sort of your production file. If you want to edit, if a filmmaker comes to you and asks for a copy, or if you want to make more derivatives, basically the mezzanine is best to be used for any sort of post-production, editing, production. And the access file is made to go up on YouTube, or you can load it to Google Drive, put it on a flash drive. The files are very small, but they still maintain a lot of quality. So the access are, best for providing access to the information. So you're also going to get a detailed transfer log, and your I messed this up, but your drive is going to be formatted to work with Mac, PC, and Linux. You're going to get your original tapes cleaned, wound, and barcoded, and also you're going to be connected to the archival and arts community. If you need help meeting somebody, if you want help. Part of that preservation access program ethos is that we're kind of bringing you into this archival community. So if you have any questions, we can talk about who you can talk to take your collection to the next level. So what you as a collection holder are responsible for, you need to sign a service agreement. And the service agreement is basically just a general contract that says, we're going to digitize your tapes and we're insured for the tapes. But the biggest thing about this is that we ask that we can use up to 3 minutes of content for promotional uses. So at the end of this, we're going to show a clip reel that's just made up of a bunch of tapes that we digitized, up to 3 minutes of each tape. And it's really important for us to have that permission to use up to 3 minutes of material from your collections, because it's really good promotion for us and it's good promotion for you. We understand, we're happy to kind of shift things around if you don't want things shown, certain items shown from your collection because they're sensitive. Again, we are sensitive to that, but in general, we ask that we can have some just use some information, some of the content for promotional materials for BAVC and for you. We also ask that you have the total amount of the discounted price paid up front before we start the work. We also ask that you bring a hard drive with the tapes. We can't really start any of the work until we have a hard drive to load the materials onto. As I said, the files are very large and they have to have somewhere to go. And then you're also responsible for the shipping costs. If you're local and you can drop them off, that's fine. If you need to ship stuff, we can help. We can print a label for you. We can kind of take care of the shipping label, but you're still going to have to pay for the cost of shipping. And then here's a little graphic of the PAP process, just a little workflow. So what happens is, you're going to submit an application, then the application is reviewed by a panel, and then if you're accepted, you're going to sign the service agreement, complete the. And this is a little boring. This is not a little boring slide. Either, I'm happy to discuss basically what the workflow processes are, but really, you apply, and then if you're accepted, you're going to bring us the tapes with a manifest. Then we're going to intake the tapes, start transferring them, and then give you a drive with a transfer log and all the files on them. So one thing to keep in mind is that, this program itself has priorities. So, we would love to digitize everybody's tapes at a subsidized rate, but we can only really do about 250 to 350 tapes per round of PAP. So for this round, we're prioritizing formats that are at risk of deterioration. So those are basically anything shot before the mid-70s or before the 80s. Stuff from the 70s is a big priority to us because that stuff is deteriorating rapidly. Collections held by individuals or small organizations. Now, if you're a mid or kind of large organization and you have tapes, you feel free to apply. It's just in a tiebreaker between a small organization and a larger organization with more funding and funding development resources. We do prioritize the smaller organizations. Also, collections that have a collections that have I'll work. Sorry, I hear that the sound quality is a bit fuzzy. Let me know if you need anything repeated. Collections that have an access and distribution plan. This is really important. Like I said, we're sensitive to collections that can't provide full access to their materials for rights or cultural reasons. However, keep in mind that you just need to describe that. If you have a fully fleshed out plan for access, you're going to be prioritized. And then also we're prioritizing smaller collections or collections where, because we can only really do up to 30 tapes per collection. So if you have your 30 tapes, if you have a larger than, if your collection is smaller than 30 tapes, that's great. If your collection is larger than 30 tapes, have 30 tapes picked out that you want to have transferred. So what gives your application an edge? Organization's a big thing. Make sure that your application is completed, that it's well written, that you're that basically that you can present a small, well-selected collection. And again, I understand that you may not be able to submit a complete inventory of your entire collection, but it's really helpful if you submit an inventory of the tapes that you would like digitized. Essentially, we're going to have a panel read over this. There are BAVC staff on the panel, but there's also local artists, local activists, local media professionals on the panel, and the panelists aren't going to know anything about your collection other than what you give them. Now, they might Google you, but really, like, you want to put everything in the application that you can present to say why it is important to digitize your materials, why, like, you should be selected, and you want to be, clear about it, and well organized. So, also, cultural significance. Make a strong argument for the artistic value or the cultural value of the content. Again, no, you the panelists are probably not going to know who you are or what your work is, so really you have to make that point clear. And then also, we want to make sure that you're committed to preservation and access. So in the application, there's a spot where it says, what is your preservation plan and what is your access plan? Again, I kind of went over it earlier, but preservation is how are you going to make sure that the materials last a long time? Are you going to buy two hard drives or three hard drives and spread the information out? Are you going to buy cloud storage? Are you going to pay for long-term storage? You don't have to do all of these, but you have to have a plan and make it clear that you have a plan. And then the plan for access. Are you going to upload the access files to YouTube? Are you going to upload them to your website? Are you going to upload them to the Internet Archive? It's very rare that applications are accepted without people who have really thought over these. So make sure that you give that some thought, and at least in the application, show that you have given it some thought. Here's some other helpful organizations that can kind of help out along the way. California Revealed will preserve and digitize materials that are related to California history. So if your materials have sort of significance in California, they might be a solution to help that can hold on to the digital files for you. Same with the American Archive of Public Broadcasting. If your collection contains public broadcasting materials, or maybe elements that were used in a public broadcasting documentary or show, you should reach out to them, and they may be able to provide long-term preservation for you. And then the Internet Archive—they're a great place to put your access files. They are not an archive; they don't do preservation, but they'll host your access files. So if you want to just say, "Hey, for my access, I'm going to put all of my files on the Internet Archive and make them freely accessible," that's actually a great plan for access. Not for preservation, but for access. And then here's how to apply. The applications are due Monday, February 8th, so that's this coming Monday. If there is some reason that you can't get the application in by then, we don't generally extend it, but let me know if you have any questions about that. The application can be found on our website, bavac.org/preservemedia/preservation-access-program. If you search in Google for BAVC Preservation Access Program, the first page that comes up will have the application on it. And then if you want to prove, you should submit a 501c3 if you're an organization that's a nonprofit. Nonprofits aren't the only organizations that are eligible, but they're prioritized. If you have a budget, we ask that the budget generally be under $500,000. If you are a small organization that's small department that's part of a larger organization, like a small library that's part of a university, clearly your university is going to have a budget larger than $500,000. But if your departmental budget is under $500,000 and you can make the argument that there isn't funds otherwise for preservation, then you can be accepted. It can happen. And then also make sure that you include an inventory of the tapes. Again, this isn't required. It isn't required that you submit an inventory, but it's very unlikely that your application will be picked unless you can provide an inventory, even a simple inventory like a list. And now, Tim Lake is going to talk about adjusting levels with time-based correctors. I'm going to switch over to him. One second, please. All right, now we're in the Zoom. And I have to allow Tim to share the screen. Go ahead and share your screen and take it away, Tim.
Okay, hang on just a sec. All right, can you see that, guys? Okay, so yeah, I just wanted to give everyone a quick little slideshow about a phenomenon that I ran into recently, which was new to me, and Morgan kind of gave me the tools to fix. So it's kind of a pretty niche situation here. It's called YC delay. And here pictured is the time-based corrector that I used to deal with this issue. So what is Y and what is C? So Y means luminance. This is how light or dark the video image appears. And C means chrominance. This is the color information of a video signal. And among a time-based corrector's many features is the ability to manually adjust the horizontal and vertical positioning or delay of the YC parameters. This allows us here at BAVC as technicians to capture a sharper image for preservation. So the reason I'm getting into this is because we recently got a collection, a lot of U-matic tapes pictured here that just inherently had a lot of like color bleeding, presented kind of a blurry image as a result of a mismatch between the chrominance and the luminance, the Y and the C. So the DPS 295, that time-based corrector, can adjust these parameters. And I just took a few screenshots of what that looks like to give you all an idea of what we can do as technicians to get the best capture. So in the above example, you can see how the color bleeds to the right. And then on the panel on the right side, you can see a sharper image once I cleared up that situation. And of course, the hue is a little different between the two images. I was just doing a quick demo today to get some screenshots, but I didn't actually adjust for the hue. Apologies for that. Here's another example. You can see right around the collar there, you can see it kind of bleeding in, but it's not happening on the right side. Same with the shoulder area. Pretty pronounced. This is the image on the left. That's not something that we want to turn in or provide to a collection holder. And then I think I have one more image. Yeah, you can see here clearly. There's just a really prominent image echo that, by simply adjusting that delay, made for just a much better capture. And that's the end of that presentation. Pretty brief, but yeah, gives you an idea of all the little things that can go awry in a capture and things that we can do to ease that situation.
I think I had myself muted. I was gonna say, thanks for that, Tim. It's really interesting. I mean, the cool thing about that is, like, so we have done Anne and I were actually talking about that same thing earlier with a U-matic collection, where there were just some tapes where the colors were like slightly off. And on that tape in particular that you had, it was like really off right off the tape. And that's not something that we usually see. My understanding is, in general, like the color and the luminance and the chrominance kind of get processed a little differently in the systems. And so those delays just kind of naturally occur in some systems. And so you kind of just use the YC delay to fine tune it back. But somehow or other, those tapes were recorded with the YC like totally off. And if you had just played it back normally, you know, there are errors that we come across that we simply can't fix. They're recorded onto the tape. And that was an error that was recorded onto the tape, but we happened to have the equipment that we needed to fix it, which was just, it's a wonderful success story. This really is. And yeah, it's, I don't know if any of you have any more thoughts on that. I love seeing those. Those are really great images. And that collection was really great. That collection was collections of art, performances, video artists, music, really, really cool stuff. I just wanted to answer the questions, and I think we'd answered most of the questions in the chat, but somebody was asking about baking and then the cost per tape. So the cost per tape differs by format and by the length. So we kind of have a base price for tapes at a 30-minute time, and then for each additional 30 minutes, we charge an extra, you know, amount. Because the price varies so much, generally to talk about it, like, in general terms. So if you want to email us at preservation@bavac.org, we can give you a rundown of our price list and make that available. And that's for like the full price list. And then if you're accepted, you'll get 50% off. Question about baking. We don't generally bake. There's some formats that we only bake if we have problems. And then some formats that we bake all the time. So half inch open reel and U-matic, at this point, we bake all the time because we found that it's easier for us to bake them all the time. And we have better results when we bake all the time than if we only bake sometimes, because we have tapes that get so sticky and so gunky that they bind up in the cleaner and the player and cause problems with the decks. And those tapes, the vast majority of them need the baking, versus the audio cassettes, VHS, we only bake those in certain cases. And part of that is that only some of those certain brands and stocks had this stuff called carbon back blacking on them, which is not the reason for tapes being sticky and problematic, but can increase the chances of them being sticky. So not a lot of VHS has that backing, but when it has that backing, it sort of becomes like suspect for possible baking. And then we'll test it out, clean it, and if it shows any signs of stickiness, we'll bake it and clean it. So it kind of depends. With audio tapes, audio cassettes in particular, those only get baked if they're sort of marked as suspect. Audio reels are baked more often. I hope that answers your question. That's a bit of a rambling answer. Okay, cool. That's it for the presentations for the most part. If anybody has any more questions, oh, sorry. So there's multiple rounds per application cycle. So we are running a single round this year. The next round will be this time next year. Some years when we have the funding available, we run two rounds per year. This particular year, we have the funding to run one round. So we're going to accept somewhere between 10 and 12 applications. So if you have more than 30 tapes, actually, you know, this is a really great question. If you have more than 30 tapes, you still really should consider applying, because what you're able to do with the Preservation Access Program is provide sort of to another funder an example of where you got funding and then had a successful preservation experience. So a lot of the times it's hard to get your foot in the door with funders. It's like the classic thing of, like, you know, for an entry level job, you need 5 years of job experience. And like the same is true for funders. In order to get funding, sometimes you have to show a history of having gotten funded elsewhere. So what I would suggest is, if you have a huge collection, you should apply to the Preservation Access Program with 30 tapes that you want prioritized. Have those tapes digitized, and then you can come back to us and get more done in the following year, or you can go to another funder and say, hey, look, I worked with BAVC. I got this award that people respect. I did this work. We got 30 tapes done. We preserved them like this. We provided the access like this. You have the whole system, the ecosystem sort of laid out. You're much more likely to get funding from a funder when you've shown that you've successfully done something like that. I hope that helps. So if there's no more questions at the moment, we're going to move on to the screening, which is, you know, my favorite part always. So sit back, relax. This is just great stuff. We're so proud of the content we've got digitized as part of this program. And if you have any questions, drop them in the chat. If there's something that we can answer in chat, we'll do that, or we'll just talk about it after the show.
Morgan, right. Can I interrupt really quick?
Absolutely.
Because we just have one more question come in. How long would the review panel need? When will we be notified if we are successful?
So great question. As far as my schedule goes, the panel is going to be held late February. You would know by the end of February whether you had been accepted if all goes according to schedule. Just due to COVID and stuff, you know, scheduling can be a little wacky, but you would be notified by the end of February. And we typically have about a 6 to 8 month turnaround on projects like this. That's actually very important to know. If you need something done right away, the Preservation Access Program may not be for you. It's simply because we just get a lot of these all in at once. We are able to prioritize some things depending on the format and the condition. You know, if it's something that's going to take a lot of time and a lot of effort for the technician, we don't want to rush it. One thing, I left it out of this presentation, but a big part of preservation is patience. And we understand that you can't always be patient. That if you're working on a production that has archival materials, you need it ASAP. If you're working on an artist collection that has a retrospective coming up at the end of the year, you need it ASAP. But just in your application, if you have any concerns about timing, put them in your application. That 6 to 8 months is sort of our turnaround time for this round of PAP. We're going to notify you at the end of February, and then by mid-March, we would hope to have all of the payments and the tapes in. Okay, I'm going to move on to the screen. Here we go. And please let us know in the chat if the audio isn't working.
This tape is a report of my experiences while introducing half-inch video to kids primarily 6 to 10 years old. I saw video as a medium that they could easily master. Working entirely with non-scripted events, I wanted to see if the kids could learn to make tapes about themselves for one another to watch. I chose this age group because of its enthusiasm and spontaneity.
might be in focus. Now, is that any clearer? See, that's the focus up there. You hold on with that hand. Take this hand and hold on the lens. Here, let me hold your hat.
Everybody look at us. Everybody look at us. Everybody look at us.
Okay. Now, if you see something you like, you can turn it on. But don't turn on if you see something you like. Okay, go ahead.
First, let me talk.
Say something, he's on.
Jamie, this is a nice house. I wish I would live here, and this is nice, and it's just as beautiful as anything around here. It's beautiful and good, and there's peace, and there's still some good. That's the end of my story.
People say that I'm too young, too young to fall in love. Dun, 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 dun. But they don't know, they really don't know. That's all that I've been dreaming of. Dun, 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 dun. I spend my nights just crying, and I spend my days dun, 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 just trying to find that love to call my own. 'Cause I'm sick and tired of being alone. Still waiting, waiting for our love.
3 billion electron volts in the Brookhaven cyclotron, aiming it at a platinum foil target and allowing it to proceed with the customary pi meson, negative muon, lepton, and nu boson decay. At this point, 1.837 meters past the target, it was subjected to an extremely dense transverse electron beam and then recorded with video camera in a bubble chamber. It should be noted that the transverse electron beam, a technique developed by Dr. Boas and the author, effectively doubles the collision energy available without introducing antimatter type interactions as in storage ring experiments. In checking the incidental results, an unusual resonance was noted in 537 events, roughly one half of 1% of the total. The proton-boson interaction energy resonated at 3.728 billion electron volts instead of 3.796, as theory had predicted. Greatly excited by this...
It's written by Gene Ritchie. It's called The L&M Don't Stop Here Anymore. My payday like I done before.
Them old kudzu vines had covered up the doorway. There was trees and grass growing through the floor. I was born and raised in the mouth of Hazard Potter.
Well, I'm going to read a few of my poems. All of them are untitled, so there'll be a pause in between the ones. So here I go. I've been so many fools, never understood the rules. I've seen the light, it's done damage to my eyes. That's the first one. On to the second. Needless to say, then why should I speak? Can't relate, so I sit and think. A crow's tongue on a crooked nail. A sailor's dream within a windless sail. The chair, he screams, relate to me. I say to him, can't you see? Mindful eyes in an endless sheet. The day is long and oh so discreet. The chair, he sits gazing at me. Then whimpering softly, he says, relate to me. I say in a hush, almost a rush, I've done as much, do the same for me. Relate, relate, can't you see? The chair, he sits staring at me. He sits in his lap, thinking to see.
If I wouldn't live in Dixon, right here in Dixon, I don't think I'd be doing what I am doing now, because if I would live in a city, I wouldn't get inspired. You have to be living in a place like this where it's quiet. It gives me a good feeling to live here. I guess you could call that magic, because I wouldn't get this feeling in any other place. If I had to move from Dixon, I don't think I'd be a woodcarver. To be a Santero, you have to play the part a little bit. You have to be careful of going out and being scandaloso, or just take things very easy, you know. Sometimes I'm a little bit of a loner. I don't go out much. I don't like dances. I don't go out to parties very much. I just stay pretty close to home. Santos were perfect people, I guess, and to be religious, you have to be somewhat, try to be a good person.
In a way, it's sort of like a drive, or and it's also like a profession, you know. Everybody has their own profession. And the reason I do it is because I enjoy it, for one reason, and it allows me to express myself to other people, you know. And it allows me to have time here at the house with my children and my wife, spend time with them. You do fall in love with your pieces, I think, not all of them, but some of them. to me, the peace was more important than the money for it, you know. And so I finally turned around and I gave that piece to my girl so that I wouldn't sell it when I needed the money.
Love music, love people who love music, give me money to put on shows. It's not just to pay myself, it's to make the shows better, really. I would love to have just like, if I even had $2,000 to work with just to get a decent sound system.
It just seems like an amount of money that...
You know, it's not that much money.
You could raise.
Maybe. I would love to have just like, if I even had $2,000, had $2,000, had $2,000, had $2,000... $2,000.
Martinez. Back up. Number one, number two, number three, number four, number five. Forward.
Fingers stretch, stretch, stretch them in front of you. Putting makeup on, and what are you going to be once you put the makeup on?
Huh?
What are you going to be once you put the makeup on?
I'm being a sick person because I'm going to have blue chattering teeth, lips, and I'm
to look sassy? You want to look sassy? Well, make a sassy face and then try to sort of make lines.
What sassy face?
You make a sassy face. Show me a sassy face. What does sassy mean to you?
Talk back-ish.
Uh-huh, talking back. Sour. Yeah, that's pretty good. Sneering. Yeah. How your eyes are little, because you don't open your eyes very. Oh.
Are you
shaking?
Yeah. You told me.
That's pretty good.
Shot. You're shaking?
Uh-huh.
Oh my God. Oh.
This should prove to be a very interesting week on AM Rochester. With your permission, we ask you to come along with us and take a look at Rochester in a different way, through the eyes of a handicapped person. Just how accessible is Rochester, New York, to people, let's say, who spend their life in a wheelchair? I'm going to be spending the entire week, the next 5 days, with Gene McGinnis. We're going to put me in a wheelchair, so we're going to be partners in crime here all week.
I think the only way to explain to you the problems and the hassles that people in wheelchairs has is to put you right in a wheelchair and take you on a little journey with wheels. And we'll do it all this week.
See what kind of obstacles we run into.
Could be a couple of them.
Well, this is our first opportunity now to see Gene's other wheels, I guess you can say. Gene, these are the real wheels that we're coming up on now. Hey, how am I doing with this thing, by the way?
You're doing real good. You're doing. I'm so proud of you, Matt.
I'm doing all right, except I think I just ran over my mic cord.
I think you got the cord cut. That's all right.
Well, okay, we're all set.
Okay, after you make the place accessible, you have to have transportation to get to each one of the buildings. The transportation in this city, as far as public transportation is concerned, is bad. So, you have to go out and do it yourself.
I'm going the wrong way.
And
let me get in position here so you can see me. Okay.
Independently, okay? I open up the van from the outside, a key right outside here. Independent, both me and you alone are going to go to the University of Rochester.
How many buildings are you going to access? What is this survey all about? Let's explain that.
Okay, we have estimated that on the outside, there's 10,000 buildings involved in this city that we have to go into with a tape measure and a fish scale and a form to survey the building.
The purpose is you're going to come up with a guide for people like you to
yes.
find out, okay, we're going to take a trip to Rochester, we're going uptown, which buildings are accessible? How can I get into this particular building in my wheelchair?
That's right.
Or if I'm blind or whatever.
Or if you're deaf. If you can use the facility because you're disabled. Now, we can extend that concept of disability to also include the elderly who are slower in mobility, which is a 20 million population, which is for the elderly alone. Also for the temporary disabled. If you got a broken leg, if you're pregnant, you're considered a temporary disabled person. Everybody can use that facility if it's 4-star with ease. If it's 1-star, the scale that you know we explained before this, if it's 1-star, that means that a wheelchair can't get in there. That means that probably cane and crutches can't get in there. That means that the blind can't use that building. So this building here, we're gonna measure it and see, first of all, the approach entrance. Is the door accessible?
Okay.
We need a minimum of at least 32 inches to make it accessible. When I was classified in the beginning as a vegetable by the neurosurgeon, I was classified as the most severely disabled person can be.
Proved them wrong, didn't you?
I surely did. And we still got a long way to go from here.
Sorry I'm late. You don't mind, do you? I don't think so.
God, you look good. Did it hurt when you fell from heaven? To me as I am to you.
You're right. Why wait?
Oh, hi. I had something in my eye.
Mom sent me up here to see how you're doing.
I'm doing very well, thank you.
Do you have enough room in your drawers?
Plenty, thanks.
Do you have enough towels?
I've got enough, thank you.
Mom and I wanted to take you out to dinner tonight. You can rest for a while first, if you'd like.
No, thanks. I slept quite well on the plane.
Oh, I've been on a plane before. To Seattle. I've never been to England, though.
Oh, it's my first time in the States, too.
The States?
What's so funny?
I've just never heard anyone call it the States before.
Oh, it's the only thing I've ever called it.
Oh. All my girlfriends think I'm really lucky to have an English cousin. I just love your accent.
Well, I've damn near walked this world around. Another city, another town, and as many miles I've been on this road. Many a mile I have gone.
We happen to end up with a couple of guys who like to raise fish and muck around in gardens better than anything, including write books about how it should be and where it is and where it should go.
We discovered we knew very little about how the world works, and that in fact science had in many senses cheated us, that we were incapable of taking a small parcel of the earth and making it sing. Science, as we know it, contemporary science, has not addressed itself to the problems of individuals or small groups of people. Our feeling was, rather than try and restructure the science establishment to become humanitarian, if you will, which we thought might be a difficult task, we thought it might be easier to make scientists out of humanitarians.
The beautiful thing in these small integrated systems is that Earl with his energy research and Bill with his agriculture and so on, we're always coming together and solving problems in common. In other words, we try and treat the world as microcosm. It's a lot of fun.
Now, when I said this is the alter ego of that one, this one doesn't have a dome cover. This one is interested in preventing heat loss to the earth. The other one isn't. This has a small solar heater. This has no filtration. And also, all the foods that go on in the...
I have so many things, and I'm wanting to write a book one of these days so I can say everything I want to say about a lot of things, because there's a lot of things to say, okay? And you also wanted me to demonstrate to you how I would close a night, right?
Right.
Okay. Everybody sing now. Good night, Charlene. I say something like, if y'all ain't got something better to do, y'all come here. Yeah, y'all good. Y'all come see us now and then, yeah. Y'all come now to the Nancy Brennan Show. Y'all come to see us now and then.
All right, thanks to everyone who stuck around. That Charlene tape is like my favorite thing ever. She really knows how to command an audience.
I think she's got sass.
She has got sass. And yeah, by the truckload. Well, if anybody else has any questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. But that's it for the night. I hope you all enjoyed it. Thanks for sticking around. Thanks to Ann and Tim for being a part of this too. And for doing great work preserving these tapes. Yeah. Any final thoughts from you two?
Just to reach out to us at preservation@bavc.org. It's in the chat. We all get that email, so we usually respond within 48 hours, I think within 24 hours usually. Yeah. And we are at BAVC, let's see, Monday through Friday, and been doing a fair amount of social distancing as well. So, you know, if you do get approved and, you know, want to try to coordinate a way to ship or drop off tapes, like, we're very lenient about that. So
yeah, good point. That, I mean, we have somebody is at BAVC every day of the week. So if you plan to ship stuff, just coordinate with us. We haven't had any problems with shipping yet. FedEx is responsive, and you know, they drop off the tapes that are in a safe location in our facility. So it's worked out very well.
And yeah, any other questions, especially like, you know, if you're concerned that the collection might have mold, you know, don't risk it. We've got all, you know, we can inspect it for you as well. So with a respiratory virus going around, don't want to make yourself any more sick. So yeah, we are used to getting moldy collections. Happens sometimes, just depending on where things are stored. So we're happy to really assess that and take a look. So anyway,
yeah, safe and sassy.
Yeah, nice comment. Stay safe and sassy.
Yeah, if you think you have mold on your tapes, take a photo and send them to us, and we can usually, you know, a photo is not 100% chance, so we can tell you, you know, one way or another what we think. Cool.
All right. I think that's a wrap.
Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.